Hello and welcome to Term 2 of Stage Combat. Over the next 2 weeks, we're going to be finishing up the curriculum for Broadsword, and then we're going to be learning assessment choreography for Broadsword. Today we're going to start with thrust attacks. Now, a lot of these next subjects are going to be extremely similar to the topics that we did in Quarterstaff. Anything that has to do with pike form, like thrust attacks, hanging parries, evasions, these are all going to be almost identical in Broadsword. So if you have not gone back and looked at those quarterstaff videos in a while, now would be an excellent time to do so before we move forward into these topics in Broadsword. So particularly for thrust attacks, go and take a look at the pike form video from Quarterstaff. After you've done that, we can get started. Okay. So our targets for thrust attacks in Broadsword are going to be the middle of the biceps for the highline targets and the middle of the upper thighs right at the base of the hips, at the base of the pockets, and at the base of the glute muscles for the lowline targets. And just like with quarterstaff, the rule for targeting is that when we are at appropriate fighting measure, we are allowed to target online. Which means, if we are at an appropriate fighting distance, one person's fully extended sword should still be about 8 to 10 inches away from the center of your chest, which means that you are out of distance. You should be able to see the tip of your partner's sword at all times in your peripheral vision. That means all of your parries are happening out here in front of your body, and it means that I could swing my sword fully extended in front of me without being in danger of actually hitting my partner's body. I might whack their sword if their sword is out in front of them, and that's generally why we don't swing it around like that. But we are at appropriate fighting distance, which means we are out of distance. And when we are out of distance, I can point my sword at my partner's targets. And that includes the highline targets that I just mentioned in the center of the biceps and the lowline targets at the center of the upper thighs, which are at the base of the hips, pockets, and glute muscles. And when I am going to be prepping an attack to these targets, I'm going to be threatening them with the tip of my sword. So I don't need to worry right now about the difference between true edge and false edge. I really just need to pay attention to where that tip of my sword is pointing. However, when I commit to my attack, my sword is probably going to get parried. And I want to make sure that when my sword is parried, I am still only making edge-to-edge contact. Now, I don't care if they make contact with the true edge of my blade or the false edge of my blade, as long as they're making contact with an edge. So, to prep an attack to a low line, I'm going to start in my nice wide broadsword stance. I'm going to weight shift back, and I'm going to prep the attack here in front of my right hip. Now, notice that the flat of my blade here is pointed up, and the two edges of my blade are pointed to the side. My right palm is pronated. My left palm is supinated, and that is so that my fingers can be pointed in the same direction, right here. And my tip of my sword is pointed directly at my target. Now, if I am left foot forward and my partner's left foot forward, I might choose to target their front hip, since that's the closest hip to us and it's going to be the most available. So I can weight shift back and I can prep my sword like this, pointing my sword at that target. And I'm going to shift from making eye contact with my partner to spotting that target. Okay, so this is the preparation position for a thrust attack to my partner's left hip. And if we are both left foot forward, it's their front hip. Now, once I've prepped the attack looks like this. Now, I want you to notice what I just did there. I started out prepped with my weight shifted back. I begin with the movement of the sword. Just like in pike form, it's the weapon that moves first. I fully extend the weapon, and then I am waiting here for permission to move forward. Whoever is moving backwards is always the person that initiates the movement. So when I am ready to prep my attack, it's me that initiates the movement by weight shifting back, and my partner weight shifts with me. Then I extend my blade to let my partner know that I am ready to attack. And then I am waiting for my partner to start moving back. In this case, my partner is going to take a passing step back, and as soon as they initiate that, I am going to move with them and complete my attack with my weight shifted forward, like this. Now, I believe I mentioned a lot of the reasons why the weapon needs to move first when we were doing the pike form video, but let me reiterate those reasons. Partially, this is for safety's sake. I want to fully extend my weapon in order to show my partner how much distance we have in between the tip of my blade and my target. That way, when we move, we can focus on that distance and maintain that distance. If, on the other hand, I start to move before my weapon moves, then we may not be aware of how much distance is between us. We might lose that distance, and then when I fully extend, we might be too close to the point where I am putting my partner in danger, and I might actually whack them in the target area. So, number one is safety. But number two, there's also a very good martial reason why we need to initiate with the sword. We need to establish that we're the one attacking. Because if we don't do that, and then we start moving forward, our partner may not recognize, if we were really fighting, they may not recognize that we are committing to an attack, and they may decide to mount a counterattack at us. And in that case, both of us get injured, both of us get hit. And I do not want that. My partner doesn't want that either. So it is in the best interest of both combatants to make sure that when you are going to attack, you firmly establish that you are attacking. That lets my partner know that if you want to avoid being injured, you have to deal with my attack before you counterattack at me. It's a measure of safety for me as the attacker because it shows my partner, my opponent, that they have to deal with my attack before they can deal with me, and therefore I'm in safer waters. I don't need to worry about them attacking me until they have first dealt with my attack. And if you are a competitive fencer, in fact, this is mimicked in the rules of right-of-way, where there will be a director watching the bout, trying to tell whether or not somebody has established an attack first and therefore has right of way. And so you cannot score a point in either foil or saber competitive fencing without convincing an outside party, the judge, that you are the one that has established that attack. And in a stage combat context, we're trying to establish that for the audience. We want the audience to be able to tell who is attacking and who is defending at all times. So it's also a storytelling principle. We're trying to mimic that sense of danger and threat in real life. Okay, so enough talking. So I've prepped my attack. I extend my weapon. Notice that I have not moved the rest of my body. I have not shifted my weight forward. I have not started to move my feet. I have simply extended the weapon. I wait for my partner to pass back. I pass forward with them. And then, most likely, my partner is going to conclude the movement by parrying my blade. The parries for these are exactly like parries for cuts. So if we are attacking the low lines, then we have a parry 7 and we have a parry 2. And in both cases, we are simply moving the blade slightly offline. And when I say slightly offline, I mean really I just need to move it so that it's not going to hit me if it was to continue moving forward. We don't want to parry all the way out here, which leaves ourselves open and moves our body offline. Just like with parrying a cut, we're just bringing the parries just outside of our target area. Okay, so that's a thrust attack. Now, after you have parried, you can do what is called a riposte. So let's assume that I am now receiving a thrust attack. So I am here, just like my partner, with my left hip forward, my left foot forward. My partner weight shifts back to prep the attack. Now, if I know that the choreography states that he or she is supposed to attack my forward hip, then I want to keep that hip open so that there's a logical reason why they would attack there. And if I was in a real fight, I might want to keep that area open so as to lure them into attacking an area that I know is going to receive an attack. That way I can be on top of things and I can parry and then respond. So I'm keeping my sword off to the right side as they are threatening this target area. They fully extend their weapon, allowing us both to see the distance in between my hip and their sword. And then I'm going to begin passing back to maintain that distance. They're going to pass forward with me. And the final piece is I'm going to parry. Now, as soon as I finish parrying, I can immediately extend my blade towards their target. And that is called a riposte. The riposte happens in one smooth, fluid motion with the parry. So it is a parry riposte rather than a parry, figure out what I'm going to do, and then attack. No, this is a parry riposte. Now, I want you to see this from the other side. So I'm here, left foot forward. I wait shift forward as they prep. I pass back as they attack, and I parry riposte. Now, I want you to notice that I have not weight shifted forward. I have only extended my blade. The weight shift does not, or the passing step does not occur until my partner gives me permission to move forward. I have simply extended my weapon, and now I'm waiting for my partner to start moving back. And then I can either weight shift forward if they weight shift back, or I can pass forward if they pass back. And which movement we use depends entirely upon which part of their body I target. And there's two ways that we can do this. We can do a direct riposte or an indirect riposte. A direct riposte will target the exact same part of their body as they targeted on me. So if we begin, like we have, with my left foot forward and they target my left hip, a direct riposte would target their left hip. Now, because their left hip is their rear hip, there's no need for them to pass back. If somebody targeted here, passing back would not necessarily move that target very much. Instead, all I really need to do is simply weight shift back to parry. So if I do a parry direct riposte, my partner should most likely weight shift back, I weight shift with them, and then they parry. Then if they do a direct riposte to my left hip, I can weight shift back. Parry riposte, parry riposte, parry riposte. And we could keep going on like this as long as we wanted. It would probably get a little bit silly. So to change things up, I can also do an indirect riposte. An indirect riposte targets a part of the body that is different than the part of the body that was targeted on me. So if we're going to keep it in low line, which is probably good for broadsword, then I have parried to my left hip and I'm going to indirect riposte at their right hip. And their right hip is the hip that is forward. And if I target their right forward hip, they are going to want to pass back to remove that target. So I extend, they pass back, and then they parry with an indirect riposte. So now let's put these movements, a thrust attack, a direct riposte, and an indirect riposte, into a sequence which you can film. Okay, so here's the sequence. I'm going to do it first, then I will talk you through it. I'm going to start, yes, left foot forward. Okay, so let's talk through that sequence that I just performed. So we're starting out left foot forward. I make eye contact with my partner. I weight shift back, prepping an attack to their forward hip, and I spot the target. Then I am going to fully extend my blade without weight shifting forward, creating the distance that we're going to maintain. When my partner is ready, my partner passes back and I pass forward with them, maintaining that distance. I end with my weight shifted forward and my partner parries my weapon. Then my partner does a direct riposte, extending towards my rear hip. I'm going to weight shift back and I am going to supinate my right palm and parry two. Then I am going to do an indirect riposte by extending my blade towards their front hip. Now, at this point, something weird has happened that you may have noticed. When I prepped an attack on my right hip, I kept my right palm pronated. And this is the standard choice. This is the default, to prep to your right hip with your right palm pronated. However, if I have just parried seven, my right palm is supinated. and there is no good reason for me to twist my hand when I attack to change to a pronated palm. Now, the big reason for that is because I do not want my partner to accidentally parry my blade while the flat of the blade is facing their sword. I only want them to parry edge to edge. So I am going to keep my sword in this position with my right palm supinated and the flat of the blade pointing up and down. So I can extend here and do this thrust attack with my right palm supinated, and then they can parry edge to edge. Now, you may have also noticed that after I attacked the first time, my right palm was pronated, and then when I parried 7, I did rotate my blade and then parry with a supinated palm. And that's because if I tried to parry without doing that rotation, it really is not going to work very well at all. I can barely get my blade over there. If I do, my point's going to be pointing out that way. So I just need to make sure that I rotate it before I have any danger of making an edge to flat contact on the swords. So I can do that rotation, and then I can safely parry 7. Now I could do a parry 1, but even if I did parry 1, I'd still have to rotate the blade in order to get there with my true edge against their blade. So the rule is you can change pronation to supination on a defensive move like a parry, but generally speaking, you do not change pronation or supination on an attack. There is an exception if we are doing a bind over, but we are not going to do that right now. So, once again, I do not change supination on attacks. I am allowed to change it on parries. So, let's take a look again at this sequence. I start with my left foot forward, make eye contact, weight shift back and prep, spotting the target. I extend the blade without weight shifting forward. They pass back, I pass forward, weight shifted forward on the end of that, and they parry. They do a direct riposte, extending towards my left hip. I weight shift back, supinate my blade, parry 7, and then I immediately do an indirect riposte to their front hip, which is their right hip, with my right palm supinated. They are then going to pass back, I pass forward, and they parry. So that is the first sequence that I would like you to film. Now I would like you to film the other half of this sequence. So let's start. Here, I'll show you what it looks like and then I will talk you through it. Okay, so let's talk through that. Just like before, I'm starting left foot forward. My partner weight shifts back, I weight shift forward as they prep the attack. I'm keeping my left hip open and that is what they're targeting. I pass back, parry 7, and immediately do a direct riposte. They weight shift back, I weight shift forward, they parry, and they immediately do an indirect riposte targeting my front hip. I pass back, and I have to do a full counter parry 2. So what I mean by that is my palm is supinated here, because I went from a direct riposte from a parry 7. And as I pass back, I bring the tip of the blade up over my partner's face, not threatening their face, and then weight shift back and parry 2, making a full complete circle with my sword. So this is a full counter or a full circular parry. So one more time, here's what that looks like. There. Okay, so I'd like you to please film those two sequences, and I want you to pay very, very close attention to making sure that the blade moves forward first. Do not start weight shifting forward or moving forward until the blade is fully extended. If I see you extending the blade at the same time that your body's moving forward, I will have to ask you to do it again. So best wishes, and I'll see you in the next video.